Actually, very privileged standing here today because I am speaking on this subject on the International Women's Day at the World Communications Forum, and I'm announcing the launch of my book, which is called Women in Business. So it gives me and thank you very much to all of you. This book, I have been thinking of writing a book for a very long time, but never really got down to it because of various things that we all are involved in. So I started writing this book last year. And this book pretty much includes various subjects that everyone can incorporate in their corporate life to succeed. And let me tell you why my book is called Women in Business. It is as language to my friends who are not women as well, men, my friends who are my male colleagues as well, because it really talks about various aspects that every person can incorporate in their life, the various do's and don'ts, so that they can succeed in business, because the challenges that we face are pretty similar. Whether it's a man or a woman, the challenges are similar. Therefore, large sections of my book are relevant to men as well. And the way I did it, this is the front cover of my book, and that's the back cover, which I'm not a narcissist, but I was told that you should profile yourself, so therefore I put my profile as well. And the inclusions largely have been my own experiences. I have 18 years of work experience, and I worked in various organizations in different domains as well. So my own experiences, and I also spoke with 5 illustrious women as well as men who have succeeded in their corporate lives, the kinds of challenges that they faced, and what did they do to overcome those challenges and actually succeed. So it's a very interesting anecdotal compilation of stories of yours and mine, which will help you and us, people like you and us, to succeed. And so that's a portion where a large section of my book is relevant to both men and women. But there are certain sections that are very pertinent only for women, and the challenges that they specifically face. And I can see some of them smiling here because they understand those challenges that they face. Yes, thank you for that. And the reason for that largely is that I'll explain it with a personal anecdote and an example of my own career. Is that when I started my career 18 years back in J. Walter Thompson in the media planning and buying team, there were a lot of women in my peer group, and it was a good representation of the world. Sorry, 50% men, 50% women. So good representation, so to say. But as I started going up the corporate ladder, the number of women kept reducing. And since the last 10, 11 years, I've been part of leadership teams in various organizations. And either I'm the only woman in the leadership team, or probably the only other woman in the leadership team. And not that I have any problem with more men being there, but my problem primarily is that a lot of talented women leave the workforce. And they leave the workforce because at a certain stage in their life, they have to attend to family responsibilities, and therefore they have to leave the workforce. And there aren't enough conditions that are created in the society that that allows them to come back into the workforce. So that is the reason why I wanted to put all this down, so that we can have a discussion, it can ignite debates, it can be thought-provoking, so that there can be certain societal changes that can be introduced. And we can bring it all to the fore, because solutions exist in our society as well. I worked in IBM for a few years, and to my mind, IBM is one of the best and the most employee-friendly organizations, because the kind of work flexibility that they give, I rarely see it anywhere else. They have work-life balance and flexible hours for women as well as for men, because they realize that it's not just the woman who has family responsibilities, men have that as well. So when you have happy employees, you have more productivity, and the percentage of women in IBM is probably very healthy and one of the best in the industry. And Ginni Rometty is heading IBM, is doing a pretty good job as well. So therefore, these solutions exist in our society. And all we have to do together is understand that, recognize that, bring it to the fore, and find solutions and incorporate it. So that is very important, because it's a women's situation for all. Today is International Women's Day, and the fact remains that it is just not today that we celebrate the fact that 50% of the population is women. I think we should celebrate it every day, not only Women's Day, maybe Men's Day as well. It should be celebrating humanity every day. But it is a women's situation for all if we have more women in the workforce, because corporates gain because there is a diversity of thought. and diversity of thought brings in many solutions to the same problem. Some of the solutions could be more cost effective, some of them would be more revenue generating and so forth. Therefore, you have more solutions which can be implemented. Now, Google is happier because she thinks probably she has a larger contentment and a higher sense of achievement. The families are happier because the mother is happy, the families are happy. And the country scale, because the GDP increases, you have more talented women and talented people in the workforce, and so do the countries. Therefore, if you look at it in totality, I think it's a win-win situation for everybody, and it will help all of us. My book is currently in process. It is not published yet. I plan to publish it in October, and since I have to adhere to the time, and your wish is giving me looks which are not very pleasant, so therefore, I will adhere to the time, but I look forward to your feedback, and I look forward to any input that you would like to give me that I can incorporate in my book, and I look forward to you all reading it also in October. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Kara Alimo. My book, Pitch, Tweet, or Engage on the Street, How to Practice Global Public Relations and Strategic Communication, will be published on August 24th by Routledge globally. Here's a quick sneak peek at the cover. I got the idea to write this book from my own personal experience in my first job working in communications at the United Nations. And I was based in New York and coordinated a team of communicators all over the world. And I would organize these conference calls every other week where I would ask my colleagues if they could deliver certain things by certain dates. And inevitably on these calls, my colleagues would all agree to send what I was asking for. And then the deadline would come, and most of my colleagues would not have sent what I had clearly understood we'd agreed. And finally, my boss had to take me aside and explain to me that in other cultures, it is rude to say no. And so my colleagues would say yes to me, regardless of whether they had any intention of ever delivering what I was asking for. And that's when I realized I needed to learn a little bit more about cross-cultural communication, and that really informed this book. For this book, I interviewed practitioners all over the world, but I'll tell you just one story that was told to me by someone at Fleischmann Hiller, one of the world's largest public relations agencies, who leads a crisis team there. And in a previous position, he was responsible for one of the largest recalls of consumer electronics in history. So the cell phones, the batteries in millions of cell phones around the world had to be recalled. And one particular store in India, people lined up down the street in order to swap out their cell phone batteries. And when the store employee explained that he didn't have batteries and didn't think that they would be arriving for another week, the people actually killed him. They killed the store employee. And this vice president of Fleischmann Hiller said to me, you know, I've been in the business for decades, I was responsible for this crisis, never in a million years would I have thought that this recall would have resulted in death. But a big part of the reason was because he didn't quite understand how he should be communicating and just how important these cell phones were. They were lifelines to people in this community. And if he understood that, he would have done a better job of mitigating this risk. So that gives you a sense of the importance of cross-cultural communication. For my book, I interviewed 87 practitioners in 31 countries. I did interviews here last year at the World Communication in Davos at the Social Media Strategy Summit in New York. I held focus groups with the help of some of the people in this room in Cape Town, thank you, Sally, in Sao Paulo and Rio de Janeiro, and I also did multiple interviews on Skype. And in my book, I break the world down into 10 cultural clusters. There's something called the Globe Study, which involved thousands of researchers around the world. And they came up with these designations to break the world down into these 10 different cultural groups. And that's the framework that I use to talk about the messages, strategies, and tactics that work best in each of these cultural groups. And unfortunately, we don't have time to talk about all of them, but I'll give you just a couple of examples of the types of things that I talk about in my book. I was just talking last night with someone about my first example, but in the Arab world, if you are going to do a television interview, it is expected that if you're talking about an emotional topic, you will demonstrate emotion. And if you don't demonstrate emotion, people won't trust you. By contrast, in the United States, if I do a television interview and I'm emotional or I get upset when an interviewer asks me a question, people will think I am crazy, right? So this is a question of understanding the appropriate way to present yourself in media interview places around the world. Another big challenge that I faced in working in sub-Saharan Africa has been brown envelopes. The expectation that if you are going to get coverage, you are going to hand the reporter a brown envelope full of money. And often that's a euphemism for a bribe, but in many instances it's the only way that a reporter ever makes money. So I talk about the challenges of dealing with this expectation and how to get media coverage when you're not going to pay to buy it. And one final example is the concept of risky communication in Confucian Asia. So in this part of the world, people are taught from a young age that talking about a problem brings more problems. And so the best thing to do if an organization has a problem is to stay silent. And from a public relations perspective, this of course is a terrible idea, and they talk about how you handle that. So just a couple of examples from the book. I think my book makes two enormous contributions to the overall literature on public relations and strategic communication. So there's a very, very famous theory of international PR called the generic specific approach, and it says that if you are going to implement your global PR strategy in a new culture, you need to take account of five things: the political economic system, the culture, the extent of activism, the level of development, and the media system. And I add two more elements to this based on what I learned from all of these interviews. One is that you have to understand social expectations. So for instance, I interviewed the VP of Communications for GE in Latin America for my book, and he talked about how in Latin America, if you're going into a new community, the village may ask you to build a school, they may ask you to build a road. And he said, don't think that this means that they trust you. They may not trust you at all, it's just that you're there and you have the capacity to do it, and so you're going to be asked. Whereas, of course, in the United States, where I'm from, if we needed a new school, the last person who we would ask would be a major corporation, we would go to the government, right? So part of it is understanding the expectations that local people will have for you in the communities in which you operate. And another big thing that I add is understanding local influencers, understanding who is influential in a particular community. And one person who I interviewed for the book talked about how in townships in South Africa, you know, finding the people who are influential can be one of the best ways to sell your product. So I wish we had more time. If anyone would like the slides, I'd be happy to email them to you. Or if you'd like more information about the book, I'll send it as well. It'll be published in August. You can find more information on my website and on my Twitter handle as well. Thanks so much.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you to the organizer for giving me this opportunity. My book is actually already out. It's been out for 6 to 9 months now. It's only available in ebook format. And what it is if you want... They don't need it. Okay. And what it is a distillation of my experience in running digital transformation projects. And so it's much more, if you want, of a practical manual about how do you run such a project, especially when you are in a large corporation. If you want, the thing that we started from, the thing that I started from, is the realization that the reason we all talk so much about social media and their influence on people and how they're shaping opinion is this. Somebody more clever than me has come up with this nice chart that explains everything that you need to know about social media with the help of a donut, right? So if Facebook is like a donut, Twitter is I'm eating a donut, and so on and so forth. Now, if you go down the list, you come to something that's slightly more exotic, like, let me see, because we have too many Russians in this room, so I'm afraid I'm not going to look good. But Ilyuliu Ponchika, can someone of the Russians confirm, that in Russian means I like donuts, because if you want to do social media marketing in Russia, you have to use VKontakte instead of Facebook, because that's the prevailing social network. And so, what do this, all these things have in common is you. The most important element of social media is actually not the technology that people are using to communicate with each other, but the fact that you have people behind keywords. And the needs and the emotions and the expectations of people actually have nothing to do with technology. I come from a technology background, so it's necessary for me to run this disclaimer every time I speak, because people expect me now to talk for the next 2 hours about the use of technology, and in fact, I don't speak anything about technology. The other remark that I wanted to make is that you're all familiar with SMSs, right? And you know that SMSs are 160 characters long. Now the question to you is, why exactly 160? Why not 200, 10,000? The cost is the same. And the reason is that SMS were actually never invented for human communication. 160 characters is the length of the programming word of a telecommunications substation. SMS were invented to allow devices to speak to other devices. And then some clever kid somewhere 10 years ago figured out that they could actually chat with their friends for free, because I'm old enough to remember when SMS you didn't pay for. No, that's how old they are. You know? And so that this illustration is a garden just outside my old office in Milan. And there's a very nice garden, there's benches and trees and everything. But the city planners did not bother to look at how people were walking in the area. And so there is a nice little path going across the lawn, where that was not supposed to happen. So my message is, technology will be used in ways that we cannot anticipate. That was always the case. People will find a way to use technology in a way that will surprise us. And we have to be ready for this. We have to be ready. Somebody, I think it was you, mentioned the fact that, you know, control is gone, right? You have realized, and you're now even pushing forward with this idea, and that's exactly the attitude that we have, need to have. We need to embrace that sort of change. I'm not going to go too much into detail, but being this Emmanuel, and having, given the fact that although I'm Italian, I spent a lot of time in Germany, so I like processes. I like things that can be broken into steps, and you can measure each step. So that's what it is. That's my infographic, and actually in the book you will find the details of each of the steps. The reason this is important at this stage is because every time I get a new engagement in this area, I scare my client off by saying control is gone and it's not going to come back. So I have to balance this with a, but there is a system. You can actually manage this process, and this is what it is. At the very end of this process, that, as I said, I'm not going to explain in a lot of detail. There is a final ingredient that, however, is very important for the success of any digital transformation project. This ingredient has been already called into cause in a different context by Paul Holmes, and I'm, instead of talking about it, and you see a gentleman here who embodies that particular ingredient. I'm going to show you a little movie if that works.
Last question.
Thank you, Jeremy. And if it's intimidating, let me know. Did you ever, in writing your books, I mean, Jenny, you maybe already, it's your second wife, you're from the States, you're full of confidence anyway, that the world needs to hear your message. Did you ever encounter that what you say is totally nonsense and the world is not going to That's what keeps me from writing. But this is all common knowledge, right? That you ever sit there and like, my God, nobody ever is interested in that. I'm not wasting my time in this self-doubting thing. I'm really interested in having a completely different cultural area. How do you deal with that, if you ever have that?
So for me personally, I've wanted to write a book for years, but I waited until I found a space where I felt like I could fill a niche. And I teach global public relations, and I truly could not find a book that explains how you adapt your strategies, how you adapt your messages and tactics. I thought the books out there were terrible, and that's why I set out to write it. So I think in looking at the universe of all of your sort of areas of expertise, it's helpful to think about what books are out there and what books don't tell the story that you're able to tell, where the need actually is, where people could better understand a communication principle or another principle of our industry. And that's where you choose to write. That's where you make your mark.
That's why you never doubt it. You sound like, no, this is the right thing to do. It's
I was desperate to find a book that I could give to my students to explain these things, and there was absolutely nothing. So maybe I was lucky that this was my field, and the books out there were just completely inadequate.
Yeah.
I think you asked this question right. I mean, I don't care.
So similarly for me, I'm very confident about my book because I have been thinking about it for many years. I started this last year, and with the people I speak with, the kind of feedback that I get, I'm pretty confident that it should do well.
Yeah.
No doubts.
Cool. Thank you.
Paul, last comment from you.
It's not so much a comment or a question, it's an answer to that last point. It's called the impostor syndrome, and you either are a real writer and have it, or you have it and you're afraid to admit it, in which case you're a narcissistic sociopath. And there's plenty of those around.
I think, can I
add to that? Part of that is, I mean, I hate writing. Okay, let me put it. Not only I don't care about whether you're going to read my book, I also hate the process of writing because it's a very time-consuming process. However, the alternative is worse. So, you know, I feel I have to write it because any other thing would be worse, would be more time-consuming, would be more jarring for me, would be more difficult. So, if writing is a shortcut. At least that's how I see. I mean, I know many of you write blogs, right? If you do think why you write blogs, that is the reason. You write blogs because, you know, what do I do with this thought? You know, I just stated it there. Well, people read it, I don't care, at least it's there. I don't know where to find it, should I need it again in 10 years? At least again.
One perspective. Thank you very much. I will just take 2 minutes to wind up the entire day's session. It's on.